greater glory of God, presence, mother of God. In the litany of the Blessed Virgin Mary, there are so many titles attributed to the Blessed Virgin. And one of the earliest and one of the most important attributes is Mother of God. And in our time, people still question about this title, whether Mary can be called the Mother of God. So many councils were held to answer these questions. The 5th century, in the beginning of the 5th century, there were so many questions about the nature of Jesus. And this was actually taken up in very different ways. And there was a very prominent teaching among the people by Nestorian, which later came to be known as Nestorianism, that Jesus was having only one nature, and Mary gave birth to the human, not the divine. So this council of Ephesus, held in 431, had to answer this question, because it's something, a very serious question about the nature of Jesus. Actually, here it is not, the question was not about who Mary was or whether Mary can be called the Mother of God. No. Actually, the question is about Christological nature, the nature of Jesus. And here in this council, that the church very clearly came to the conclusion with the prayer and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit that Jesus is the Son of God with two natures. The two natures, both divine and human. And here, the person is divine. Please note, the person is divine. As written in John chapter 1 verse 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This Word is the second person of the Most Holy Trinity, who took flesh from Mary. See, here we need to clearly note the attributes, the words used here are very important. In John chapter 1 verse 14, we read, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us." This Word took flesh from Mary. See, the person of the second person of the Most Holy Trinity takes flesh from Mary, not through any human intervention, but rather because of the intervention of the Holy Spirit. It is with the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not any human intervention here, about which we can read in Luke. In Luke, we very clearly see this reality that Jesus was with two natures. The person of Jesus was with two natures, that's both God and man, divine and human. And the heresy was that Jesus was not really human. There were so many other heresies which said that Jesus was not God. Then some heresies, Jesus was not fully human. That's why in this council, and takes time, it's a process, because it involves God Himself. That's why it's a mystery. So please pray to God, pray to the Holy Spirit. If you are still not able to accept this reality, understand or comprehend this reality, you need prayer. A clear conclusion and a dogma was made, in which it is stated that Jesus, the Son of God, the second person of the Most Holy Trinity, has two natures, both divine and human. How is it possible? It's a mystery. It's a mystery in the sense cannot be known. No, you're wrong. Mystery is a reality which cannot be easily comprehended by the power of the human intellect. Mystery needs God's help, His grace to be understood. And it cannot be understood like any other truth or any other scientific proofs or realities. But it needs to be comprehended with humility and prayer and also with acceptance. This dogma still was again stressed upon, saying that Mary is the mother of God. The council was called not in the name of Mary, it was in the name of Jesus. But in conclusion, it had to say, the council had to conclude that Mary, mother of Jesus, is the mother of God, because Jesus is God. So it is not Marian, or it's this dogma is not actually about Mary. It's about Jesus, His nature. And so the council gave the name Theotokos, the bearer of God. So in this council, as I said, it concluded that Jesus, the Son of God, has two natures, both divine and human, but only one person. The person is a divine person. That's why Jesus cannot be called a human being. Jesus is surely human, but not human being. Being in the sense of a person. Jesus is a divine person with a human nature. So these two natures, Church explains this theologically, it's a hypostatic union. Let's not much complicate this reality, but let's accept that there are two natures, both divine and human. That's why Jesus is called the perfect mediator between God and man, because He is both divine and human. And further, this was explained in the Council of Chalcedon in 451, which states, I would read for you, begotten from the Father before the ages as regards His Godhead, and in the last days the same, because of us and because of our salvation, begotten from the Virgin Mary, the Theotokos, as regards His manhood, one and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten. So it was again reinstated, that fact. Then, if you want to question that, how is it that we can call Mary Mother of God? Still, there are biblical proofs where Mary is called Mother of God. In Luke chapter 1, in Annunciation and also in Visitation, both the places it is very clearly stated. Luke chapter 1, verse 34, Mary asked the angel, how can this be, since I am a virgin? And the angel said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. So it's very clear. The one who is going to be born of Mary will be called Son of God. Not a human being. There is no a man involved, a human man involved here in the birth of Jesus. No. And to be more clear, in Visitation, when Mary visits Elizabeth, after her greetings, when Elizabeth is filled with the Holy Spirit, she proclaims, it's not actually Elizabeth again. If we clearly read through the scriptures, we'll note that it is the Holy Spirit. See, in verse 41 it is written, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. Dear friends, here you see, when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, she was filled with the Holy Spirit, because Mary is with the child, and that is by the power of the Holy Spirit. And Jesus, the Son of God, who is in the womb, is also with the Spirit. The Spirit was there present, and that is the cause of Elizabeth being filled with the Holy Spirit. Because of Mary's proclamation, that greeting, that sound, that voice through which Holy Spirit entered Elizabeth. And it is the Holy Spirit who proclaimed through the mouth of Elizabeth that this woman who is with a child is to be called the mother of the Lord, mother of God Himself. Because Mary did not give birth to the human person. No human person, as already I had noted. It's the divine person with the two natures. Just to conclude and to summarize, Mary is the mother of God because Jesus is a divine person with the two natures, both the divine and human. The divine nature is already eternal, co-eternal with the Father, begotten of the Father, as in the Nicene Creed we read. And the human nature He obtained or took upon Himself from Mary. So it is Jesus, the Son of God, having two natures, both divine and human. And so He is God-man. He is both God and man. But be clear with the fact that Jesus is not a human being. Meaning to say, He is not a human person. He is a divine person with both the natures. And so, if Jesus is God, Mary, who gave birth not to the human nature, be clear about it. She gave birth to the person of Jesus, who is the Son of God. So Mary is to be called the Mother of God. May God help us to understand this reality, not about merely Mary, but rather it's about Jesus Himself, who is our Savior. And when we accept Jesus as the Son of God, it implies that we accept Mary as the Mother of God. May God bless us. Have a wonderful, fruitful, and blessed day. May God bless you.